Jazen. I am currently a rising junior in Berea College. I came from Myanmar. I am majoring in chemistry and physics, and I'm from the class of 2016.
And I'm Carlos Andres. I'm an international student from Bolivia. I'm part of the class of 2017. And my majors are computer science and chemistry.
We are making a documentary about the international students in Berea College and their experiences in the US so far.
You will find it interesting because if you're an international student,
you will be able to relate to the experiences of these students. And if you are an American student,
you will be able to see the different perspectives that these students bring to the country. Mm-hmm. And if you're parents,
you will get to know what your children go through and how they live as they study abroad. Please enjoy.
I grew up there, but I was actually born in Argentina, as well as in South America. I'm a sophomore this year, and I'm a business administration with a concentration in marketing major, and as well as an Asian studies major. My focus is Chinese, the Chinese culture.
Kamarjoba, my name is Megi Papiashvili. I know my last name is complicated, that's fine. I'm from the Republic of Georgia, and probably that explains why my last name is so, you know, long and strange. The Republic of Georgia, by the way, is not a southern village of Russia and has never been, so please stop writing that in your history books, dear Americans. And my majors are political science and Spanish, and I would love to be a teacher, and I want to teach political philosophy. And I'm a member of Thier College, class of 2016. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Moon Gil Jahan. Usually I'm known as Moon because it's easier to remember. I'm from Bangladesh, it's in Southeast Asia. Right now I'm a sophomore at Berea College. I'm a member of class of 2016. My majors are biology and art history, and minoring in chemistry and probably Spanish, I'm not sure.
With a dream, my cardigan. Welcome to the land of fame, excess. Am I gonna fit in? Jumped in the cab, here I am for the first time. Look to my right and I see the Hollywood sign. This is all so crazy. Everybody seems so famous. My tummy's turning and I'm feeling kinda homesick. Too much pressure and I'm...
I was really surprised. The plates are really big and also the food is a lot. I can't finish that. And so during the first 3 months of my arrival, I was practicing American way of eating. So I gained like 15 pounds in the first 3 months. And then I had to reduce it again after that by a little less.
My first cultural shock was when I went to food service, a cafeteria. I was so surprised about the size of the plates because they were double size to what we use at home. So at first I was surprised, I didn't know how I was going to fit all the food in the plate in my stomach because I'm used to putting a lot of food in the plate. Since the plate was so big, I didn't know how to eat at all. I ate all my food and that's how I gained 16 pounds in 2 months. It was a very depressing period because I thought that I was immune to gaining weight. Apparently, I was not. I tried to lose weight.
I saw that people ate potatoes here with the skin, with the peel, and that was really weird. Then I got used to it and I love it now. Then I also had another cultural shock with the size of the dishes and the size of the silverware, like the spoons. They were really big. The teaspoons here are like almost the spoons that I used to eat normally at home. So they are gigantic, but it's good. I can fit more food there.
Until now, I cannot still not finish a dish that I order from the restaurant, I always feel so full when, like, when I'm halfway done with the dish. And I think it's one of the culture shocks because people in here eat pretty much, like, way much more than people in my country do.
My teacher took me in a Mexican restaurant, I think, or it was just a regular American, I don't remember, anyways. And then we ordered food and here comes this huge plate. I thought, oh, maybe it's a cultural thing that people are supposed to eat from the same plate. Mm-hmm. Not really, it was for me. I was like, how am I supposed to eat that?
Yeah, I agree.
It was big. Uh-huh. Yeah.
I like the food in restaurants. They bring a lot so I can eat. And sometimes if I go with other people, they don't finish it and I can get to eat what they don't.
Came to Berea, I think it was more of a weather shock than culture shock, because one day it's snowing and right on the next day it's so sunny and hot, and I don't think I'm used to this weather shock yet. I'm still going through this weather shock.
I hopped off the plane at LAX with a dream, my cardigan.
How to deal with people, because like the concept they have with friendship and acquaintance here is really different from my country. For example, back home, if you have talked to someone once, or if that person is in your class, or if you just by some means know that person, then it's so normal that you would say hi to that person when you run into him or something. But here, like, basically, even now, like, I don't really know the boundary or the limit of saying hi to someone all the time or not saying hi to someone all the time or things like that. So I think the social interaction part is one of the major culture shocks I had.
The first time I got here, I noticed that while people go into the house, they don't take off their shoes. But in my country, when we go into the house, we take off our shoes. It is like a sign of respect. You clean yourself, like put them in a specific place, tidy and neat, and then you go into the house, something like that. But here, people don't take off the shoes. They just walk around the house with the shoes on. So I find it really interesting. The other one is, it's about the people. In my country, the people are very considerate of how you're going to feel and think. For example, they want to ask for help, but they would think a lot about how you might feel if they ask for help, if you would be able to do it, or if you are going to feel uncomfortable or not. So they might not go out and ask you for help or something like that. But here, when people want something, they will ask you directly. And if you say yes, then yes. And if you say no, then they are just okay with that too. And so in my country, if you want to offer something, you have to offer it more than once, like two or three times, until they say yes. The one or two times they refuse, it's just the cultural thing that they are refusing. So it's also interesting.
One more about academics is that here they are very focused on due dates. So it's they put a due date and you have to finish by that time, and it's like, they are very punctual on times and everything. And it's different from my country. If you say something like at a specific time, you go there and other people show up like half an hour later. Sometimes they just don't show up, or they can appear to your house any time they want without even telling you. It's really annoying. Yeah.
my other cultural shock was to see that people were actually very friendly in Berea. People hugged to each other. I was expecting that everybody would be cool and serious, nobody would touch you. But people hug, so I'm very happy that there is that human warmth here in Berea.
In Berea College, when I first came here, one thing I noticed at the very beginning is how the students are so friendly with the professors, and actually some of the professors preferred to be addressed by their first names, and that is not at all familiar to me because we always address the professors or teachers as sir or ma'am or doctor something. And recently I experienced an interesting event. We were in a class in an academic setting, and I was sitting in the front row. I always sit in the front row. And the professor was looking for a pen, and she just told me, "Oh, I see you have a pen, just toss it to me." I cannot just toss the pen to her. I mean, she's my professor. I just stood up, walked up to her, and then gave her the pen, and she was like, "Oh, Moon, you're always so disciplined and modest," but that's just how I am. That's how I see the professors. I cannot treat a professor as a friend or in an informal way. It's just the way it is in my country, and that's how I was brought up. So this is one thing that came to my mind first when I think about culture shock.
Here, the public display of affection is really widespread. So you can see the couples like kissing and holding hands is common in my country, but kissing and like hugging and those kinds of acts is very common here. But in my country, we don't usually those physical signs of emotions, so it's a little different. Yeah. So this is one of the culture shocks here for my kid.
It was when all the other American students came to the dorm and they had lots of stuff. They brought a lot of stuff with them to the room. When I came to the US, because of the airline restrictions, I had only two suitcases, and I felt like I had everything with me. But when I saw all the girls come into the dorm with no, like, 5 or 6 or 7 suitcases and boxes and all the other hangers and stuff, I was really overwhelmed. And I felt pretty like, oh, I'm so small, I'm so lonely, like they are so different from me. That's my very first culture shock. Maybe because of the very hectic schedule that people often are very busy with their own life, and we don't have much time to interact with each other. And even from the first year, from my freshman year in college until now, things have changed a lot. Like, we no longer have a lot of time to hang out with friends anymore. Everyone had assignments, homework, clubs, activities, and other events to plan to attend, and something like this. So it is something that is very different from what I experienced in my country, because back home we can hang out whenever we want, pretty much. Like at the night time it's time for hanging out and having fun, so we just gathering and went out and eat and chattering around, so much fun. But in here, especially in Berea bubble, not really.
Another thing that I found shocking in my experience here during my first days is the cost of medical health care in the US. I had a problem, a small problem with dehydration during the first day that I was here. And then I had to go to the hospital, and they took me in ambulance to a different hospital, and I stayed there one night, and they had to do an endoscopy, which is not an operation, but a surgery. But at the end, my bill was around $13,000, which luckily the insurance from the college covered about half, a little more than half. So, but that was shocking that they charge a lot for that. Just the apples was like $1,000. And they send you a different bill every time, that for every different service that you receive, you get a different bill instead of paying just one bill to the hospital and they take care of the bill. And that was... The good thing about that is that they are not so... They don't press you to pay so much as in my country they would. But still, it's very expensive. But you have flexibility in payments and they can give you more time if you need. For example, in ways that you have to pay, you can ask for more time, like an extension of time. You can pay monthly part of the bill, so they every month they reduce some amount that you pay. You can also pay in full, usually that's harder. Or they, you can usually apply to financial aid from the same hospital, and if they accept you, they would reduce the bill or they can cancel it altogether, which is good. So there is always, if there is a problem like that, there is always, it's always good to ask what are the options.
So first was Jonesville, Wisconsin is absolutely beautiful, amazing place. But the thing, first thing that really amazed me was the fact that houses don't have fences whatsoever. Back home, you can't see the house. It's like the walls are so huge around the yard or whatever, you know what I mean? But the houses here are just beautiful, small, modest houses without huge fences. You can see people inside, you can see pretty much this world. And you know what makes me feel like they really trust each other? And when I was growing up, protected, and you know, like people have these, you know, wires and everything. It was great. When I got in Berea and we had our first test, I was not done on time, you know, being international. It takes double time to understand vocabulary and everything, especially with my English. I mean, at the time it was even worse.
Mm-hmm.
And my teacher gave me a paper and sent me to another room and said, once you're done, you bring your paper. Mm-hmm. And I was so amazed. Like people back home literally stand with guns to look at you and make sure you don't cheat.
Mm-hmm.
And this again, this trust, I really appreciate that. It's amazing.
There she goes again.
In the first year, usually we have a housing assignment with a domestic student, and in the second year you get a chance to choose your own roommate. And for most of our international students, we chose an international student because we are a family, so we would want to live with someone you can really relate with. In first year, I was rooming with a domestic student, and the only thing we had in common was our major, biology, and we were always so much busy with our classes. Because I was taking a biology class and she was also taking biology and chemistry class. So we hardly had any time to interact. And most of the time it was me sometimes in the room alone. And when I used to go out to study in the library, then she used to be in the room. So we really never had any time to sit and talk or interact. And my current roommate is Beza, and she is also a class of 2016. And I see my rooming experience, it's more like an extension of friendship. It's like we hang out during weekend all together, all the internationals, and then when we go back to our room, then we would just converse what just happened, or we would just share our fond memories, or something fun happened in a party, we would just share with or talking about it again, or laughing about some of the jokes that happened in the party. So I find it more enjoyable because we can understand each other so well. So in order to live together, you need to choose a roommate who really understands you, and also who can have good time with you, and it's vice versa. So I'm really happy with my roommate too, and I will be rooming with her next year as well. And I know some of my international students, they're also keeping their roommates because we're just one big family. So yeah.
Let's see, I knew nothing about who I was going to room with when I came here. Even during the international orientation week, I didn't know anything. And then I met Linda, the girl from China, and she asked me if I looked up about my roommate on Facebook. And I just realized that, yeah, why didn't I do that? So I looked her up on Facebook and I found her. She put a very weird last name on Facebook, and it was so funny. And then I added her on Facebook, we became friends, and she asked me about the room because I was already in the room. So I told her that the room is so small and things like that. Actually, to me, the room is not that small, but I know that for American people, the room is so small. And then she just came, and the very first day, I remember that her mother told her that I looked like I'm freaking out because I was really nervous, and I felt like, oh, how am I going to get along well with that person? I know nothing about her and things like that. And I think for the first semester, we were not really talking a lot, but then for some reason, we just started getting used to each other. And she always tell me, she always did, and she always does now. She always tell me to take her clothes to wear whenever I want, because she has tons of clothes. And I said yes, but I never did, because I feel awkward to take some of her clothes without her, like without telling her. She told me not to tell her, but I feel awkward. And then she told me later that she thought that I didn't want to wear her clothes, mm-hmm. So she wanted to remind me again that I can use her clothes whenever I want. So I feel like, okay, so she really wants me to do that, so I can start doing that. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I borrow her stuff, and she's a very nice girl. And I'm so glad that I keep rooming with her until my second year, and we are always very good friends. And whenever we have problems that we cannot talk to anyone, mm-hmm. We can tell each other and we can talk to each other. Sometimes we cannot find the solutions though, but it's just the feeling of sharing with someone. So I really consider her one of my close friends in here. So I really like her. It's just a very, very sad thing that she's going to study abroad next year. Next semester, so I'm not going to be able to room with her anymore. So I feel like, I don't know if I ever want to room with anyone else, or maybe I'm just trying to get a single room. I wish that I could get a single room. That's all. Yeah.
That's a little. Hi, Pew Pew.
Hello.
So you have been here already for 2 years, and you have a roommate, right?
Yeah, I have two roommates.
Okay.
One in my first year and one in my second year.
Right. Could you share your experience with us?
Okay. Well, my first roommate, who was Brianna, she was really interesting. I was not so curious about who was rooming with me, but I kind of found her on Facebook, and the first thing she wrote is, "Hi, my roommate," and that's it. And I liked that sentence, and that was all we had for the first time. And then I came to Berea, and then she is really an interesting person. And on the first day that she arrived, her mother told me, well, she doesn't like people much. This is the first impression that I got from her. And then like, oh, you're a person too, so do you like yourself? And then she was like, oh, I like myself a little bit. And that was how we actually started sharing the room. And we don't usually talk, and she is pretty quiet. And it was pretty okay, because I don't really like to talk much anyway. And the first time we teamed up together was when our food was stolen from the fridge. Like, we have a common fridge that we share in the living room, in the kitchen. And then we put some of our stuff, and then our stuff were stolen. And this is when we actually started talking. And then she was so frustrated because her food was stolen, and I was really angry because my food was stolen too. And then we were talking about it. So the very very interesting talk we had was about food. Our food getting stolen, so that's kind of interesting. The rest was pretty normal. There was one time she was actually very nice to me. And because I was late for my final exam, like for an hour. So I rushed to there and I kind of bumped into a can that I was drinking and it fell over my side and my laptop was there and I didn't have time to clean up because I ran out. And when I came back, she cleaned up everything and it was really kind of her. I really appreciate it. And we don't really have much roommate conflict. Sometimes we just don't talk. And that was it. So
in my second year, I could choose my roommate. So I roomed with my friend. She's from Bolivia. And we're really good friends. And we get along so well. And we bought things together to decorate the room. And it was really fun. It is really fun because I'm still rooming with her. And also in next year too.
When I first found out about my freshman roommate, I wasn't really that concerned about the roommate issues because I had a lot of things to take care of back home before I came here. So she was the first one to contact me. That she emailed me and she said, oh, you're my roommate, and she told me her name and everything, and some things about herself. So when I came here, she wasn't like a total stranger to me, but I got here first, so and she came in later, and I think I bought her some cookies or something as a welcome, so I can remember that. So throughout the year, we were really good roommates, but like we didn't really have any big issues of like getting into each other's business or something. And she's not here now, she has transferred to another school in her own state, so we just check on each other sometimes still. And after that, I had Moon as my roommate, who was also in this documentary. And we're friends, so it's more simpler, but not really that different because we weren't really that strangers to each other with my former roommate as well. So I think so far I have a good roommate experience. Yeah, I'm happy with my roommates.
When I came here, my roommate didn't appear, didn't show up for the first week, and I couldn't contact him before.
Mm-hmm.
So I wasn't sure if he really existed. I looked for him on Facebook, on Google, and he never appeared. Later, after I had my room for myself, like for 2 weeks after coming, and then someone told me, or they told me that he wasn't coming anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So they assigned me a new roommate who came, and he was all the time outside, so I got my room for myself almost all the time when I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, he was really nice, and I never really needed to talk to him.
Mm-hmm.
So that was also nice. And well, later he had to go. He just decided to drop off from Berea and go to a different college. So
mm-hmm.
on my second semester for my freshman year, I had to be assigned with a new roommate,
mm-hmm.
Which didn't appear for like 2 or 3 weeks. So
mm-hmm.
I had like 3 weeks for myself again.
Mm-hmm.
And then they put someone who, my new roommate was someone who didn't talk at all.
Mm-hmm.
And well, I am not very talkative too. So far the semester is about to end and we haven't talked yet so far. But recently I found out his name, so that's good.
How many months has it been since you first started rooming with him?
4 months.
Four months?
Yeah.
So you haven't started talking to him yet?
No.
That's a strange roommate you have there.
Yeah, well, I think it's better.
In my first year, when I was coming to Berea, I didn't know who my roommate was. I knew her name, but I couldn't find her on Facebook. I knew that my international friends through Facebook had found their roommates through Facebook. So I wanted to do the same. I wanted to be able to Skype or to chat with my roommate, to be able to talk about our accommodations in the room. So I never found her. So I was so desperate that one day I went to the Berea Facebook page and I put my roommate's name and I asked her, okay, hello, I'm Erika, I'm your roommate, I'm looking for you. So please, if you see this, email me because I want to talk to you, roommate. So my dad told me later that it was funny because I looked like looking for a lost dog. And she, when I met her, she told me that they had given them given her my second name, which is Anaï. So that's why she never found me. I don't know why I couldn't find her, because I had her real name on Facebook. So we had a really good relationship.
It was very interesting to have somebody different than me. She likes tattoos, and she likes to miss classes, sleep a lot, watch TV. So it was interesting. We had a really good relationship. What I hated was the TV. She had a big TV. I never told her that I completely detested the TV. I used to tell her, could you turn off the TV because I need to do homework, and she would do that. At the end of the year, it was obvious that she was getting tired of me always telling her that. So I realized that we needed a change. We wouldn't be compatible one more year. But in general, we had a really good relationship. She had a fridge, so she let me put my fruits there because I never bought food. I usually brought fruits from food service and put them there, including banana. Until one day in the second semester, she told me that she detested bananas, and she asked me if please I could take them out of the fridge and never put bananas again in the fridge. So I can imagine she had to stand the smell of bananas for an entire semester, and she had never told me that. So I appreciate that she was that kind with me. But now we talk to each other every time we see each other. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I enjoyed my roommate in my freshman year. It was very interesting. I remember one day when I forgot my key. I went to the study room to do homework, and she was in the room. And it was Saturday morning, and she had gone to the Simri Center to run.
So when she came first, you know, international students, we got here first and we stuck with each other and everything, and we are, you know, like expecting who is gonna come and what's going to happen and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then she came, and I was planning, you know, to show my friendliness and everything, and she opened the door, hi Jenny! And then she looks at me really scared. She was not really expecting that. She was almost intimidated. Mm-hmm. And that was like first thing, that there is a barrier, Maggie. Make sure that you don't cross that.
Mm-hmm.
And then,
mm-hmm.
then I asked her, since I got here first, I settled down. But then I asked her, you know, would you like me to change my side? And would you, you know, I tried to give her as much space as possible.
Mm-hmm.
But she was like, no, I'm fine. No, I'm good. I'm good. I'm good. And like, first couple of months was basically not talking at all. Like,
uh-huh.
It was not like we didn't have good relationship or anything. She's just, I think it was not only me. When I was sharing my experience with some of my friends, they had the same problem, not necessarily problem, but, you know, different situation that they did not really talk with their roommates.
Mm-hmm.
But today I'm rooming with her.
Yeah.
Right way of putting rooming with her. I don't know.
Uh-huh.
She's still my roommate, and I'm very happy with her because first she's very organized, and by organized I mean she's clean.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have seen some of my international friends' roommates' room, and it's just really shocking. I mean, no offense, like, you know, this is their life and they can do whatever, but it was really shocking that their bed was never made and their clothes was on the floor. It was, what? My roommate never does that, and I'm very happy. She's super friendly, and she's real. So I really appreciate that very first time she was not like me, hi Maggie! You know, it took her time to get to know me, and I appreciate that. She's very nice. I'm happy with her.
Okay.
My host family, it's first I was going to have a host family like the same as my sister, but they decided that it would be better for me if I had a different one. So they assigned me a different host family, a couple. They have kids and they are grown up, so they just live alone. And they invited me several times to events like Thanksgiving. They also invited my sister. So we got to cook Bolivian meal with them and spend time and have my first Thanksgiving with them.
I signed up for a family that would have kids and, you know, like a real big family. And my host family, my host parents have 3 kids, almost my age. And first day when I met them, I came back from church, and then I wear skirts, you know, like I always wear skirts, and I had these blues and whatever. And then I met them, and my host mom was very quiet, and it was kind of uncomfortable because, you know, when you first meet somebody and people are really quiet, I was a little, I don't know, uncomfortable. But today I consider them to be really, really nice people. I mean, I consider them at that time too, but I get to know them better. Mm-hmm. And again, they are really, really real. Like, when they smile, they mean it. And when they say a word, they mean it. And they made, like, one of the most beautiful birthday parties for me. And they made me try pumpkin pie first time in my life. it was really cool. Okay. So next time she was asking me, if you want to go with us with dance practice or something, but maybe you don't need to be dressed up. And it was funny for me because she said that I was dressed up with this skirt, but no, my host mom, I really wear skirts. I have a very nice host family. Before coming here, I remember the application. There were several sections to choose from about a family. And I chose a family with a kid. I could have chosen a family with no kids, single person. I think those were the options. And I chose a family with a kid because I didn't want to be alone with my parents because I thought it would be awkward. But now I feel that it would have been a very interesting experience, like my brother has grown kids. They are very kind. They are very similar to me. I mean, my personality, they are quiet. And I lived with them in my first Christmas break. It was a very nice experience because I got to eat food, fresh food, and I got to sleep in a bed, in a comfortable bed after one semester of sleeping in my dorm. And they didn't have internet. So I used to go to visit my friends because they had internet. And so it was really nice because they live a block away from me, half a block away from me. And now I don't see my host family very often. I see my host dad sometimes because he works in the same building as I do. And they gave me a Christmas present in February this year. So I really enjoy it. I haven't finished using it. I need to go to Papelino. They gave me money for that. So I'm very happy with my host family.
Yeah, that's very kind of them.
My host family is very nice. The CIE, the Center for International Education, they made a program for like pairing the students with the host families, and I signed up for this. So I got a host family for that after that. And my host family is Asian, and I like the fact that we are Asian because they cook really good foods, that my favorite type of food. And my host family is really warm and friendly. They invite me over their house during the Christmas and Thanksgiving, so I get to spend time with their family. And they have three adults. They are working, and some are going to graduate schools now. And it is a very nice thing that I'm having like a second family here. And sometimes on my birthday, they take me out, and they would take me to Lexington or the places nearby to buy things. And also sometimes they give me presents during the Christmas and Thanksgiving break too. And it's very kind of them.
When I came here, I saw many other international students signing up for a host family, and to me, I just feel like, okay, I feel like I cannot get along well with someone just because the school assigned them to become my host family. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I would be obligated to try to get along well with them. But mm-hmm. actually, I'm a very picky and difficult girl. Mm-hmm. So I say, no, let's not let anyone suffer me. And so I didn't sign up. And sometimes I feel a little bit lonely when I see my friends going to their host family to have dinner or mm-hmm. stay with them over the break. And I was thinking like, yeah, it would be better if I have a host family. And then in my second year, just I think one or 1.5 months ago, my supervisor, I have been working for her since the beginning of my sophomore year. Mm-hmm. She emailed me and she asked me if I had any host family, and I said no. And I asked her why, and she said that I would love to be your host mom. Mm-hmm. And I felt so moved. I really like, because I really like her, and I know that like she is just like my mother at work. So I feel like, yes, I definitely want you to be my host mom. Mm-hmm. So she became my host mom, and she drove me to Richmond, had lunch with me. She always think about like going somewhere, and she asked me if I want to go with her. Like, she always take care of me mm-hmm. a lot, even before when she was a supervisor, and now as a host mom. So I feel really grateful for that.
Lately, I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. But baby, I've been praying hard. Said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars. Yeah, we'll be counting stars.
The cans and everything, and they recycle them, reuse them, and also they reduce the waste as much as possible. Also, I'm currently living in the Deep Green, one of the most sustainable dorms across the campus.
There I get to practice the sustainable lifestyle. So I want to take it back to my community, because in my community, the idea of sustainability is not very widespread.
What to say? I would love to bring the individualism back to my country, because Vietnam is one of the countries which has the collective vision community. And I think the combination between individualism and collectivism will bring a very strong community in which the individuals can develop and can take most out of themselves to develop themselves and hence develop the community. Because I like the way people behave in a very independent way, and in, they have very high self-esteem in here. And back home, people care more about the community, care more about social pressure and things like that. So I think when the two sense of communities combine together, they can support each other and make it a better community, I think.
If I have to take something from US to my country, it would be work ethic. Because here, so far it's been almost 2 years in Berea, and I have seen people are always showing up on time, whether it's work or whether it's your class or whether it's your rehearsal for any cultural event or anything. People always show up on time. And also when you are working on any project, maybe on any project related to your work or your studying, they finish things on time. So I really like this aspect of the work ethic, that you can really make things done in US, which is not the same case in Bangladesh.
Everybody is on time for things, or early. And I have always been used to being on time for things. Sometimes my mom, for example, she is always late. If we have to go for a party, or meet with my relatives, we say, let's meet at noon. No, we don't do that. I mean, she likes to take her time and always arrive late. So I always felt frustrated with that, probably you too. So I'd like to make people realize that our time is important and we need to appreciate other people's times and be on time.
Well, for me, what I would like to bring is also the neutrality here into my country. And also, I would like to bring the Berea system, the kind of work, labor, maybe working at the same time, like learning in the universities. And in my country, usually you don't live on campus. You live in your own house and you commute to the university or college. So I would like something more.
Some parts of their college education system, especially the studying abroad part, because back home when I was in college and for all the other students who are in college, we don't really have any opportunity to study abroad or to be part of exchange programs or something like that. So if I could, I would take that opportunity to the students we have back home so that they would have a chance to come and study in US or in any other part of the world.
The first thing that I would like to take from US is the liberal arts system. The education system in my country is a little bit different. In my country, one woman are good at studies, they are expected to go to the medical university, and also one man are good at studies, they are expected to go to the engineering universities or something related with naval offices. But here in the US, you can study what you want freely without social pressure, but there are also a set of courses that you are required to take, and they are very good for your personal and intellectual development. And I really like the system because you can choose whatever you want. You don't really have to follow by the social expectations, like becoming a doctor or becoming an engineer when you don't want to be. You can just really choose what you want, and you can try, and you can follow your dreams. And I really like that system.
The Berea system, the work and the study program.
the students work, they learn experiences, and then they bring them and they can combine them in their academic areas, which prepare them to be better workers in the future. So I also want to take that system.
I completely agree. Educational system is absolutely fascinating, because back home students are fighting to get education. We don't have books that we need. We don't have, I mean, I'm probably exaggerating a little bit, but we need to make copies and we need to, transportation to college is just horrible. And people here and teachers and everybody, TAs, are just motivated to see results, their product in you. And this is amazing. So I completely agree with the educational factor. And another thing I really want to take is food. I mean, seriously, Georgians, you don't have pumpkin pie? We have all kinds of pumpkins, like, seriously? Okay, food is another thing I really want to take. And then, okay, just to become a little bit more serious, I want to take diversity. Because I don't think Georgians are like, I don't think anybody is born to be racist. We are raised to be racist, you know what I mean? They teach you to think that black people are not as good as white. This is absolutely, absolutely horrible. And I always felt like it was not right, but even one day if I decided, you know what, I'm gonna get married to a black guy, some of my relatives will kill themselves. And also Asians, like we see an Asian looking at people and we say, oh, this is Chinese and this is African. I mean, dear Georgians, there are many countries in Africa and there are many countries in Asia. So I want to take diversity, and I'm so blessed to have so diverse group of people around me, and I think this is amazing, and I want Georgians to, the rest of the Georgians to know about it.
Something that I really miss from my country here is to be able to find markets where I find vegetables. I mean, seeing the milkman going house after house with the cart carried by horses and selling fresh milk, not processed. That's something that I really miss, and I would love if that could be something brought to the U.S. where people stop processing so much, because there is a need for things to be fresh and natural. And now we see the high obesity rates of the US. They are going up every year. And it's because they don't have a good way of feeding themselves. They eat too much processed food. They don't appreciate the food. I think that we should be self-sustainable, and we should sustain ourselves through our food, consuming fresh food, local food, because besides helping us by having less chemicals in our bodies, because you are eating chemicals when you eat processed food, and that's disgusting when you think about that, you are also helping your environment, because you are not putting more chemicals, more fertilizers into the ground to have, for example, GMO. You are not buying food from other countries, from other states, to bring it here, and that is, you are using fuel for that, and that goes to the atmosphere. So if you are more sustainable by consuming fresh and local food, you are helping your communities, your environment, and your families. So that's something that I would really love to see here and to bring here to the entire US.
Okay.
Something that I would like to bring, maybe, or maybe compare, is that in my country usually we don't throw food so much like they do here. So I would like to change that, because it's a lot of waste that could be used for something more beneficial than just trash, mm-hmm, or compost.
Like giving it to the indigenous people who don't have houses.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think that's sustainable. Why do you have to throw away the food? Like restaurants do. you could give it to somebody in need.
Okay. If I have to bring any element from Bangladesh in US, it would be the way of greeting. It took me a while to realize that here people are actually, when they ask how are you, that doesn't mean that they're actually wanting to know how you are. It's just a way of saying hi. And in Bangladesh, we do really want to know how you are. So I would just bring that way of greeting here, a way of warm greeting, I would say. So that's one element I would really want to bring from Bangladesh to US.
The other thing that I want to bring from my community to here is spice. There's no spice. I mean, the spices are so weak here. And whenever someone says that, oh, it's really spicy, I was like, wow, let me try it. And it's nothing at all. In my country, we eat a lot of spices. One of the possible reasons is because in my country, the weather is kind of like very, a little bit hotter, a lot hotter than here. So we try to add spices so that adds up to our appetite. That's probably one of the reasons. But here, they don't eat spices. They can't stand it. So I want to bring the spices to here so that I can eat spices here.
Okay, that's nice. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
Street food from Vietnam to the States, because Vietnam is one of the best countries in the world about street food, and we have so many kinds of street food and very like cheap and easy to access too. So we always have food to eat and like very good food. But in here, every store is closed at 6 on Sunday, and what, like at 9 in the evening, the only place I can get food is the cafeteria in school. Or otherwise, I have to walk to Walmart, which I never went to. So I really want to have like lots of food stands on the street, and at night time, which you can just walk there, get some very cool thing and eat so good.
So far, my experience here has been great, and I'm really happy to be a part of Berea, and it's almost halfway through college, and it's pretty hard to believe because it feels like just yesterday when we came to Berea. And the greatest gift I would say that I've received from Berea so far is our close group of friends of internationals, and I'm happy and proud to be a member of this international family.
Our love runs deep like a Chevy. If you fall, I'll fall with you, baby. Cause that's the way we like to do it. That's the way we like. You run around open doors like a gentleman. Tell me, girl, every day of my everything. Cause that's the way we like to do it. That's the way we like. Just a little west coast and a bit of sunshine. Hair blowing in the wind, losing track of time. Just you and I. Just you and I.